I've been a member of the New Orleans Regional Black Chamber of Commerce since 2017. I've always wanted to be in a creative space, to be able to help businesses, but to also be able to express my own creativity. The New Orleans Regional Black Chamber of Commerce has been a strong partner for our business. They've connected us with resources to help us grow. Anytime you can join an organization like this, it's a benefit. It's certainly going to help you grow your business.
NORBCC is a resource and a voice for Black businesses. Join today.
I've been a member.
Good evening, and I'm Laverne Timms, the Executive Director of the New Orleans Regional Black Chamber of Commerce. Thank you for joining us for tonight's Straight Talk series, along with the Hispanic Chamber of Louisiana, titled Hurricane Preparedness. As many of you all probably heard that the federal government stated not too long ago that the 2021 Atlantic hurricane season is again expecting to be busier than normal, with 13 to 20 named storms, 6 to 10 of them hurricanes, and 3 to 5 reaching major hurricane strength of Category 3 or higher. Again, I want to thank the President and CEO of the Hispanic Chamber of Louisiana, Myra, as well as our panelists for sharing your valuable and timely information. In regards to NRBCC, we've been around for 15 years, and our mission has been to support and promote and educate our Black businesses for sustainable growth and expansion within the 10 parish region. If you are interested in becoming a member of NRBCC, please do not hesitate to contact our office at 504-948-0991, or email us at laverne.toombs@nrbchamber.org. And again, you can always visit our website, which is www.nrbchamber.org. As a chamber, our goal is to continue to be a resource and a voice for Black businesses and entrepreneurs. In our next slide, you will see that we have a number of webinars that we have quite a bit during the month. And so again, if you would like to see what webinars that we're hosting during the month, please visit again our website at www.nrbchamber.org. So again, thank you for joining tonight's webinar. And without further delay, I'm going to turn the webinar over, or the next portion of the webinar over, to the President and CEO of the Hispanic Chamber of Louisiana, Mara. Mara.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mara Pineda, President and CEO of the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce of Louisiana. And thank you, Laverne, for this important partnership in presenting this important information tonight. As you well stated, I think business owners understand how critical it is to be prepared for hurricane season. And with such an active season, and after the last 15 months that we've all navigated through, more than ever, our business owners need to know the key and important points that they can't miss for their businesses to continue to grow and scale and rebound from the impact of the pandemic. So the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce of Louisiana, it has been advocating very fiercely for our business community and making sure that we foster a favorable business environment for our Hispanic business owners to thrive through the pandemic and beyond. We are inviting our community to join in our very, very diverse programming throughout the year. You can visit our website, hccl.biz, and always call us at 504-885-4262. We have our foundation site as well that has wonderful computer literacy, financial literacy programs, and many other services that the community needs, in addition to workforce and training and job placement opportunities. We've been an advocate for the supply chain and procurement, access to capital, and many other important topics for our community. As we know, minority communities have been disproportionately impacted through this pandemic, and now is the time to bond together, and that's why this is so important today to work together with the New Orleans Regional Black Chamber to serve our communities. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you to the wonderful speakers and to the audience for being here today. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our panel of speakers today. Mr. Colin, you can introduce yourself.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Colin Arnold. I'm the director of the City of New Orleans Office of Homeland Security and Emergency Preparedness, coming to you from City Hall. My office maintains the city's crisis and consequent management planning. What that means is we're an emergency management function primarily. We prepare and respond and mitigate any type of incident or disaster that may befall the city. And tonight we're speaking about hurricanes, which by far in Louisiana and in New Orleans is our number one threat of disaster that could occur to our area. So we spend a lot of time really year round preparing for hurricane season and for the next storm that may come our way. And thank you for having me.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jason Lewis. I'm the president of Noah W. Lewis & Associates. We are a minority-owned, family-owned, independent insurance agency based in New Orleans East and serving clients throughout New Orleans and the surrounding area. I'm on board to answer any questions or provide any information related to insurance, risk management, and preparedness, and how to evaluate the various coverages that you may or may not have so you can have a better understanding of how insurance helps to mitigate your business's risks and what information you need to be able to glean from your policy so that you have a thorough and clear understanding of how that insurance fits into your overall risk management program for your business. Our agency focuses specifically on working with small and mid-sized businesses, as well as on occasion working with large institutions to manage their enterprise risk.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Joe Norris. I'm the Deputy District Director for the Small Business Administration Louisiana District Office. We're located in New Orleans, but we actually serve the entire state of Louisiana. And in addition to providing assistance to businesses on a regular basis, be it financial assistance or management and technical assistance, training and counseling, we also provide assistance during a time of disaster where we are able to provide low interest, long-term loans of up to 30 years to small businesses that have been negatively impacted by a disaster, and also to homeowners and renters who have suffered a loss in time of disaster. I have more than 40 years of experience with the Small Business Administration, so we look forward to assisting you.
Good afternoon. My name is Angel Cavilla. I work with FEMA. I am a floodplain management specialist stationed in Florida, but supporting the state of Louisiana right now. We have been supporting the different parishes on the recent declarations, Cameron, Calcasieu, and others, mostly coastal. But we continue working with the communities to provide that support in order for them to recover in a way that it may make the constituents, your citizens, resilient for the future so that you can recover now and reduce your risk later.
Good afternoon. My name is Gerald Johnson, and I'm with FEMA's Community Education and Outreach Group. I've been with them for about 11 years now. And our focus is on risk reduction. In fact, my job is to teach people about how to reduce their risk from future disasters. I am honored to be working with the great people in Louisiana. I've been doing so since September, since the first of the storms. And also am joined this evening by two of my coworkers, Ms. Amelia Pino and Mr. Paul Averson. Amelia, would you introduce yourself, please?
Thank you, Gerald. Good evening. I'm very happy to be here. Thank you for having me. I work with Gerald in FEMA. I'm a community education and outreach specialist. We help people before, during, and after disasters how to rebuild better, safer, and stronger, and a focus before on preparation for disasters. I am working in Louisiana. I have been here since September, and we're here happy to be of help to the community and the population of Louisiana and all the other disasters that we serve. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Paul Albertson. I'm also with FEMA Community Education and Outreach. I've been doing this for about 15 years, and the reason I'm here today is I'm tired of seeing pain and suffering after storm, disaster after disaster. And I think your preparations are very important. And I hope not to ever have to come and help you personally. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Giovanni Arenas. I'm with Garcia Insurance Services. I'm a commercial insurance specialist that helps the Hispanic community in Spanish and English. And I'm here to let you know that we enjoy supporting our clients with their insurance needs. That most times, because of the language barrier, we take our time to help them understand their policies.
Kim. Good evening, everyone. I'm Kim Carter Evans. I'm the Vice President and Managing Director for True Fund Financial Services.
South region. True Fund is a community development financial institution, also known as a CDFI. And we are one of the go-to and sought-after CDFIs as it relates to small business disaster recovery. We've been supporting small businesses pre, post, and during a disaster that dates back to Hurricane Katrina, multiple hurricanes across the state of Louisiana. We have supported small businesses in New York post 9/11, the great floods of 2016 in Baton Rouge. And of course, now we are mobilizing capital to small business owners who are most in need as it relates to COVID-19 recovery. So looking forward to sharing additional information on how you can not only access capital to support small businesses in preparation for impending disasters, during and after disasters, as well as business acumen training through our resiliency and preparatory programming.
Well, thank you, Kim, for that, and to all the other panelists for sharing your expertise. So we're going to go right into the questions. And again, as Kenneth mentioned earlier, that Myra and I are going to be asking you a series of questions, which I believe that you all have received in advance. So the first question, and this is actually a question that is kind of personal for me, is in regards to what advice would you give a business owner with regards to preparing an emergency plan? What is exactly an emergency plan for a business owner, even a homeowner? And anyone can, I guess we can start with Mr. Arnold with the city.
That's a great question. We're talking about businesses. We're talking about continuity of operations, really. What's important is that there's a documented plan or way forward when a business has, you know, been affected by a disaster such as a hurricane. You know, how does that business, you know, what we've realized is that recovery depends on businesses, particularly small businesses, getting back in order as soon as possible. You know, and lessons we've learned from, and we've learned lessons that other places in this country, we've had painful lessons, you know, Hurricane Katrina being one. But I think what you're seeing with COVID is you've seen a disaster that has taken effect over a year, affected a lot of businesses. Not exactly, you know, the same as a natural disaster, being that there's, you know, obviously, you know, kind of see it coming. There is a response, there is a recovery, and you see somewhat of a finality or an end. And I think we're going to get there with COVID. But what you've seen is businesses on the brink, and there's, you know, ways that people need to plan for these types of events, you know. And what I'm seeing just from the introductions, and I think a good you know, a good reminder that we're all having is insurance. You know, the various different types of insurance. And we're talking about hurricanes, flood insurance is so crucially important.
Is there anyone else that want to talk a little bit about the plan, or is there a template? Does FEMA, SBA, do you all have like a template for a small business owner?
I can add to that, if you'd allow me to. It's very important to have an emergency plan for your business and your home. And what I mean by that is make sure everyone in your household or business knows and understands your hurricane plan. You need to have a plan, a communication plan. Where are you going to meet? If there's a evacuation route, know your evacuation route, where everyone is going. And so you can do it in a timely and safe manner. Recognize between warnings and alerts. Also, it's very important that you keep in mind if there's anyone in your business and in your household with disabilities, they might need special preparations. So you need to have that in mind. Review your important documents, your insurance, your IDs. Try and strengthen your home in preparation of a disaster. declutter the gutters, bring in outside furniture, consider hurricanes, shutters, stuff to minimize or eliminate damages, and get tech ready. Have extra power for your devices and so on. There's so much that you can do to prepare before, during, and after. And I recommend that you go to ready.gov. There's a wealth of information there that will help you. And especially for businesses, there's a toolkit that will be helpful for you and educate you. Thank you.
I'd like to add that on SBA's website, our ASCENT website, we have prepared a disaster journey that's a part of the ASCENT platform, and it guides the small business owner in preparing a plan that specifically addresses the particular mode that they may be in. If they're in just startup mode or growth mode, if they're still in the process of setting goals. So it covers that, but it also covers and gives some ideas on what you can do to help your employees in terms of maintaining contact with them and some additional resources and services that you can offer to them, because keep in mind, if your business is impacted, then it's possible that your employees will be impacted. And it's important to let them know that you care about them, their well-being, and the well-being of their family. But on our ASCENT platform, and that's ASCENT.SBA.gov, there is a disaster journey that will walk you through putting together a disaster plan and also in putting together a recovery plan.
So Joanne, if you don't mind, put that in the chat so that our viewers will get that information. Mara, do you wanna go to the next question?
Yes, absolutely. And I'd like to jump right in with our insurance specialists here, Mr. Lewis and Giovanni. Can you tell us, how does a business determine the kind of insurance that will protect them? And I can speak to that, you know, from personal experience. During Hurricane Katrina, I was the owner of some subway shops. And I'll confess, I was not totally covered. And I learned, you know, the tough way. So obviously, this is very important for our small business owners, especially to be very aware of. What exactly do they need? Mr. Lewis, you want to start and then Giovanni?
Sure, I'd be happy to chime in. When it comes to businesses and their insurance needs, it will vary depending on the type of business you have. As you mentioned, you owned a number of subway shops, you were a franchisee. That would be different than if you were a CPA or some service-oriented business. So in the event of a storefront type of business, of course, there is the liability aspect. You have customers coming back and forth. You don't want someone to slip and fall or have an issue that they get injured on your property. But today we're talking about property insurance. So if you have a situation like you're faced with a hurricane, you want to make sure your location is physically insured, as well as all of the items that your business owns inside that location is insured. If you have something like a retail business, you want to make sure you keep copious notes and track of all of your inventory and all of your work in process. All of that should be appropriately insured. And along with the property itself, you want to think of some of those ancillary coverages that will protect you if your business does have to shut for a period of time. These are things like business interruption insurance, things like extra expense insurance. And those two are similar, but they're actually not the same. And we can get into more detail of how they differ as we go further along. Another thing you want to make sure you understand is how your various deductibles work. If there's a claim, there is a certain percentage of the cost of that damage that the insured will have to bear. And here in Southern Louisiana, in almost all cases, there will be something called a wind and hail, or a named storm deductible, which is a percentage of the value of the property being insured. It's not just the flat dollar amount. So being aware that even if a claim rises to the point where your insurance policy responds, there is going to be some amount of financial responsibility for the insured to help with the repairs of that building.
Exactly. Yes, that business interruption, very important. And Giovanni, you want to add to that?
Well, Mr. Lewis explained just about everything we can have to explain on insurance, but very important will be to read your policies, to understand what your policy it's all about, because sometimes you don't realize you're missing some of those key things that he mentioned until it's too late. So understanding your policy, taking the time, if you have questions, call your agent. Your agent can take the time to review things. And don't forget, there's no dumb questions. Ask as many as you have, because it's better to learn before than after the fact.
I have a question in regards to FEMA, and that is flood insurance. So do you all want to elaborate a little bit on that? Because that's a little bit different than, I guess, from what Jason and Giovanni is talking about. So do you guys want to just elaborate on that?
Yes, definitely. So one of the things, in addition to what Mr. Lewis and Mr. Arenas added to the to our panel, is that there are a couple of different types of insurance. You have flood coverage, flood insurance, and then you have the one that is wind, rain, what it's called the hurricane or storm insurance. So if I try to identify as a business owner and as a homeowner, the type of risk or peril that may affect you. If you're in a flood prone area, it is very important consider, well, for me, it would be a must purchase a flood insurance policy. If you are the owner of that structure, purchase building coverage and also property coverage. That would be for the for your contents, and it can protect from damages to the building or damages to the contents that make your business continue. So if you get your machinery inventory damage, there are clauses within the insurance policy that may provide coverage for those ones, and that will provide you with some continuity moving forward on with your business, so that the time that it takes for you to recover would be shortened a lot.
Absolutely.
If I could add to that, there is a 30-day waiting period in most cases, so it's important to get it before the storm's coming. I'd also like you to know that the lower the risk you have, the lower the rate you'll have. So a lot of our claims do come from outside of the special flood hazard area. In other words, people don't think they're going to get flooded and they don't have flood insurance, so it's really worth considering.
I'd like to just quickly add that when we're talking about NFIP policies or the National Flood Insurance Program, typically those policies cap out at $500,000 of coverage for the building and $500,000 for contents. If we're talking about a business, perhaps it owns a warehouse that's worth $1 million with $750,000 of inventory inside that warehouse, it's important to know the limitations of the NFIP policy and speak with your agent about possibly purchasing an excess flood policy, which could bring those limits up to the value of your property being insured.
Another thing is, if you ask an insurance agent if you need insurance, flood insurance in New Orleans, the answer is going to be yes, no matter what zone you are in. So just remember, we live below sea level, so everybody needs flood insurance. And very important, it's very affordable if you are in an X zone. So get your quotes and you'll be surprised to see how inexpensive it could be and how useful it would be in the case of a flood.
So Kim, I have a question for you, and it may not, it's not on, on here, but it just kind of dawned on me in listening to damages. And I know that you are a CDFI, especially as also at SBA, but as True Fund, when someone have damages like a business, is there something, some sort of product that you all have that coincide with SBA or something aside from what they offer small businesses?
Yeah, so True Fund has its own core disaster recovery products, but we always wait for the insurance assessment first and then the SBA assessment, and we come in to fill in any gaps. If the insurance coverage and then whatever capital they are able to attain through SBA, if there are any gaps that are left, the CDFI like True Fund can come in and offer our loan product to make sure that they get the full dollar amount that they need to cover those various damages. Now, we're not necessarily, looking at damages that were done to physical components of the business, but loss of revenue. So we really look at, you know, if they had a loss of revenue, if they need additional operating capital, if there's certain equipment that was damaged that was not covered by the insurance or by an SBA loan, we can also help support that. And then most of our dollars for disaster recovery also comes by way of the Department of HUD and CDBG dollars. And that capital takes, it tends to take quite a few months after the disaster has happened. So again, we come in after they have already been assessed by their insurance carrier and the SBA when those CDBG dollars, which is community development block grant funds, come into play. And that's generally based on the disaster designation by the federal government.
Excellent. And that's so critical because we know that small business owners, micro business owners depend on every dollar for sales for every day to make ends meet. So thank you for that, Kim. And circling back to what you mentioned, Ms. Jo, regarding employees, how do you prepare employees for a disaster period, and how do you keep track of their whereabouts?
What we do and what we encourage is that they have a database or a system where they actually have the employees updated annually with where they will go, what their safe haven will be, also to provide us the contact information for where it is that they're going, if it's a relative or just a friend, give us their contact information as well, and provide us with multiple numbers where we can reach them, like their personal cell, but also their spouse or a significant other, or even if it's a child or other relative. So we encourage to get all of that contact information so that you can follow up with them. And then immediately where you get to your safe haven, to reach out to them. One of the things that we had to do, and I actually was the lead on that, every day I had to touch base with our entire team. And it wasn't just via email, I had to actually call and talk to them. And that's how we learned that one of our staff members, we weren't able to reach. And in fact, her daughter had not been able to reach her, but we maintained that contact. We even reached out to someone that we know at the Corps of Engineers and with the Army Reserve and had them go down to her home. And that's where we found her. She was in her attic. But it's just to have that direct point of contact with them. And I know everybody is texting and emailing, but nothing beats that personal phone call. And our team was very appreciative of that. And the ones of our small businesses with whom I shared that information started doing that with their employees as well. And it helped them with loyalty, to let them know that you're just not a name on the books or someone who comes in here and turns on your computer or answer my phone. You mean something to me. So having them update their emergency contact information regularly. And then also, we share just some additional tips based upon personal experience with them as well, and encourage them to employ that. And even, you know, with, okay, do you have this in your disaster kit that you're going to grab when you're running out of the house? So just sharing that personal information with that, with them from personal experience, goes a long way as well.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to weigh in?
Can I say, Joanne, thank you so much, because this is actually a phone. You know, we've gotten so into the age where we email and text, and I have to remind people that, you know, did you talk to this person while I emailed them? No, call them, you know, and I think that it means a lot. And we do the same thing at the city, particularly with our employees. You know, we require this to be updated, a very similar list to what Joanne was talking about, by May 1st every year. All of our public safety agencies do the same thing with their employees and their families. It has to include their plan and contacts, a contact out of the area. You know, technology has gotten better as far as getting in touch with people, but it's really important that as a business owner, that you do this with your employees, because I think it also level sets expectations about kind of like what I mentioned earlier. There will be a time where you're going to need them to come back and to be ready to work and get back and get the business going again. And it's really important that if on the front end you're doing this, that on the back end they know what the expectation is, like, you know, we're going to get back to work.
So now, with that being said, when we talk about damages, right, when a small business owner has received damages to their property, what advice would you give them in regards to how to assess those damages? Is that something that they do, or is this something that insurance or FEMA, how do you go about doing the assessments?
So I could just share from SBA's perspective. We always encourage them to take pictures of the property if they're able to do it, and to take before and after pictures if they're able to get the after pictures, because sometimes they need the money immediately. Okay, so one of our assessors may not be able to get out to the property. If you're able to get there, then you can take pictures, or you can have someone take pictures of the after effects. But we always encourage them to take before and after pictures and be able to share that with our analysts and the damage assessors when the time comes.
FEMA?
I'll second that. With regards to pictures, you know, a picture is worth 1,000 words. It goes a long way in demonstrating what the state of the property was prior to the incident or the event and what the actual damage was. If an insured is able to get to their location and they can safely do so, they should take whatever steps they can to prevent further damage from occurring. If it's possible to put a tarp on your roof, if it's possible to board up a broken window. If it's possible to do those things safely, you should do so. But ultimately, from the insurance company's perspective, when it comes to evaluating what the damage is, that will be the job of the insurance adjuster. They're going to make that determination as far as what the damage is going to be. And along those lines, we were talking about just general preparedness and having a plan. Put all of your documents on something digital. Put it in the cloud, put it on a thumb drive. It's so easy to save documents electronically now. So I know in Katrina, so many people lost so many documents. There's really no reason to not have immediate access to your important documents now that everything can be digitized.
Thank you.
Thing will be also to put the claim as soon as possible. Safety is first, though. but put the claim as soon as possible if you realize that there is imminent damages on your property.
And FEMA, I know that you all do assessments too, right?
Yes, mostly on the FEMA side for small businesses. When they open an application through the, when they call the 800 number or they enter their applications through the online, the website, they get a referral to the SBA program, which allows them to obtain low interest loans to recover, to help the recovery efforts. And there's a personnel from the SBA agency that will go and assess those damages. Those are different from your insurance assessment. So be aware that you need to call if you have damages caused by wind. You need to call a specific agent. If you have a different policy and a different agent for flood damages, call that other agent. And another phone call would be to the referral to the SBA program, that it would be a separate assessment. So need to be aware of those things. And to add to what Mr. Lewis said, your documentation, if there's people that would like to have paper copies, there are watertight envelopes or protective envelopes. If you wish to have everything on paper, then get copies and have those watertight envelopes and have them with you or in a protected place, just in case that's your preferred way to go. But again, everything available digitally that you can access from any phone, that would be the best choice. But you do have options to have your documentation.
Angel, I'd like to ask and follow up with what you're saying to specifically refer to what kind of federal assistance for business owners does FEMA have, does SBA have, so that we can kind of narrow it down to business owners?
Okay, well, in the part of FEMA, the individual and households program is for that purpose, for individuals and households. Small businesses or, businesses itself, they can get a referral to the SBA program that allows them to obtain, that they may obtain a low interest loan for their recovery purposes in their businesses. And that's that would be also on top of what insurance could cover. Let's say, for example, that insurance cap at a certain point and the low interest loan can help them further with recovering whatever inventory they lost or anything that they lost. Then they can combine what insurance covered to a certain extent and then try to recover that portion that they didn't get from their insurance. And that would be a great help on the recovery efforts.
Ms. Joanne, what can you add to that for, after you receive those referrals for business owners?
Okay, so for the business owners, we have two things available. We'll have the $200,000 low interest loan for 30 years for the physical portion of it, which would include damage to the building and also loss of materials, inventory, and even equipment. And for the loss in the revenue, that's where the economic injury disaster loan comes in, and we can go up to $2 million for businesses as well. So let me correct that. It's $2 million for businesses, and I'm thinking about the homeowners too, because the homeowners lose things. So it's $200,000 for homeowners, $40,000 for renters, which would even include replacing a vehicle, and $2 million aggregate for our business owners. That would be for the economic injury, disaster, and or the physical loss of property for business owners. And all of those loans are 30-year loans. I want to add something to what Angel mentioned, and that is following up on that referral, where many of the business owners and even some of the individuals missed out in getting assistance, is when FEMA referred them to SBA, they did not submit the application. Rather, what they said is, I'm just gonna wait and see if FEMA is going to give me something else, or if HUD is going to come up with some additional money, and it does not come, and they've missed the opportunity to apply for the loan. They should apply, even if at some point they say, okay, I don't want the loan, at least submit the application. Don't miss that window of opportunity. But to answer your question, Myra, $2 million for business owners.
Can I add to that?
Of course.
Absolutely. What people don't understand is that there are thresholds that have to be met in order for many of these programs, particularly FEMA, to kick in. SBA has really been a lifesaver for us with certain events we've had with minor flooding events. I mean, we call them minor, but for the person that lost their car or their house, it's pretty major, right? And so their threshold for SBA, you know, is manageable. Even locally, we can work with SBA and try and get those loans kind of going. So I have to agree 100%. Apply for everything that you can, because you don't know exactly when. I mean, we're just starting to look at Zeta individual assistance right now, and within the last month. And that was a storm that took place last fall. So it's just one of those things. You never know when you're going to meet thresholds, when things are going to kick in, and it's good to just avail yourself of everything you can as soon as possible.
And very important what Joanne mentioned is, even if you later say, you know what, I don't need this, I'm not going to use it, then you have that, you know, decision-making opportunity to just say no, but at least you have an option when you do need it. So thank you for that. Okay.
And also, Kim, again, I know that you spoke earlier about, you know, being that gap, right? But can you elaborate a little bit more about that? Because we just heard from, you know, SBA in regards to the funding and a 30-year loan, right? So what about TrueFund?
So for TrueFund, there are times where a small business owner has accessed their insurance. They've also accessed possibly a small business loan, but most of the individuals that we get are the ones that Ms. Joanne just spoke about, that for whatever reason they decided not to apply for the SBA loan and they have missed the deadline. And so your CDFIs or your smaller banks that have access to additional disaster aid can step in, and you know, if they've missed that deadline, because our deadlines are just kind of ongoing, we don't have that definitive, but SBA does have that definitive per disaster. You have to get your application in by a set date. And with TrueFund or with other CDFIs, we have this ongoing rolling application period, especially as it relates to those CDBG dollars that I spoke about. Generally, once those dollars are dispersed, the lending agencies have at the very least 12 additional months to take in applications. And sometimes those programs can go up to 24 months. So that's just a much longer period of time for business owners to really have an opportunity to really think about the dollars that they've already taken on, to look at their debt load, to look at if they want to take on additional debt, to see if there's going to be additional grant programs. And that if it's not and there still is an existing need, then they can tap into those available CDBG dollars through CDFIs.
Thank you, Kim. So let's stop. Go ahead, Mara.
Colin, does the City of New Orleans identify evacuation locations, evacuation routes? How do you communicate that to the community?
Wow, that's a big question. So yes, is the short answer. The longer answer is it's a plan that actually exists between us as a city, our state partners, and with our federal partners, with FEMA primarily. And it's a very dynamic plan. First of all, when we call for a mandatory evacuation, it would be for a storm being a category 3, 4, or 5 storm. In other words, a major storm that's going to cause a direct impact on the city. And every storm's different, and we know that. But when that is triggered, you know, a day and a half, 2 days before, you're going to see, you know, a mandatory evacuation called for by the governor of Louisiana, by the mayor of New Orleans, other parish officials and other local officials are all going to be saying, everybody leave. And so 90% of people self-evacuate. So they're going to get on the roads. We have what we call contraflow, where we can run the interstates all out of the area. You know, that's an evacuation route. Evacuation routes on state roads and interstates are marked with evacuation route signs. And so for, you know, many people, that is what they're going to use to leave. For about 10% of our population, we know that through mobility, medical, and typically financial and transportation issues, they're gonna need assistance. And we have the city assisted evacuation. So we have 17 pickup points around the city. All of this is on ready.nola.gov. It's, you know, we can also come and speak about it to any neighborhood group, church group, business association, anybody who wants to talk specifically about this plan, we can. But yeah, those 17 pickup points, we utilize RTA transit buses to pick people up from those stops. We move towards the Smoothie King Center, which is a processing parish pickup point. And then from there, the state brings in motor coach buses, which move people, and we can also use air and rail to move people out of the city to safe haven, to ride the storm out. And then the process works in reverse on the way back once if the city is safe, once we've started things going again, the economy's going, and we can bring people home safely, it works in reverse.
Well, I want to thank Anna for putting that information in the text, because that's what I was going to ask in regards to your alert system. And I must admit that I am doing it right now. I know that we had an alert system in St. John Parish. So I'm going to do that right now, right now.
That's something that as business organizations, we're going to be sharing, you know, around this time and until, you know, it's not no longer needed after hurricane season, but it's important to be communicating this regularly, because people forget, you know, especially small business owners when they're busy with their day to day. So yeah. Thank you very much, Anna and Colin, for that information.
We have a really terrific team with NOLA Ready. You've probably seen a lot of their things, both with her, the record-breaking hurricane season last year, and then also the pandemic, but yes, NOLA Ready to 77295 will, if you text that, NOLA Ready 77295 will get you all the alerts we put out for pretty much everything going on in the city. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you. Thank you.
So I'm glad that we talked about that. We talked about assessments and, of course, you know, the importance of the evacuations. But again, I just need some understanding in regards to insurance experts here. Why in the world do, when there's a named storm, that the deductible increases? Can you help me out with that?
Well, the deductibles don't increase because of the storm.
Okay.
Those deductibles are set when you sign the contract of the policy. Now, if you have a high deductible, it was probably because the business owner was trying to minimize the price of the policy. Let's not forget something very important to understand is, like, there are different types of deductibles in the policy. There is what's called AOP deductible, all other peril deductible. And there is the 4 different types of deductibles that you can see related to a storm. So you have the hurricane deductible, you have the named storm deductible, you have the calendar year named storm deductible, and each one of those have their own way of paying out. The wind in hell deductible is one that it's probably the most used in commercial policies, and it's going to be that percentage that Mr. Lewis mentioned, the percentage, and it's the percentage of the total policy, not the percentage of the loss. So we have to keep in mind that if we are going to pick a high deductible, we're not going to go with a 2%, we're going to choose a 5% because we want to minimize the premium on the policy. Make sure you understand that it's 5% of the total coverage. So that can really hurt you at the end. So, I mean, the best thing to do will be see what you can afford and buy it and understand what you're buying before it's too late.
And just a little about the reason deductibles are structured in that way. When you think of an insurance policy, you can think that both parties, both the insured, the person buying the policy, and the insurance company are trying to mitigate and hedge their financial risk. If your house gets blown down, it's going to cost you a lot of money to rebuild it. That's why you buy your insurance policy. However, on the insurance company side, they recognize the issue that's most likely to cause damage to your building, especially here in Southern Louisiana, is wind or a hurricane. And because that's the most likely cause of damage, they're trying to minimize their financial risk by putting a little bit of that burden onto you by way of that percentage-based deductible. So it's going to be pretty unavoidable here in our region. Now there are products out there called deductible buybacks. It's almost like a very small policy that the sole purpose of that policy is to pay for your large wind and hail deductible should an event happen. But when we're talking about small business owners, that's typically not as available and not as cost effective. If you have a $200 million property portfolio, maybe it makes sense to look at a product like that. But it's just the nature of the beast here in our region that you'll have a percentage-based deductible for wind and hail and hurricanes.
Thank you. So Kim, are there any other services that TruFund provides for business owners to prepare for hurricane season? I know you've been talking about how you fill in that gap, but tell us a little more about what TruFund can do for business owners in preparation.
Sure. So in preparation, annually and all year round, we have what's called our Renew program. It's a business resiliency and disaster recovery preparatory program. So this really assesses the resiliency of our business. And we do this by way of a scoring card, assessing things like insurance. You know, do you have adequate insurance? Do you have that communications plan in place? And that scoring model gives them a score based on the number of yeses that they're able to give versus the number of no's. If they score on the lower end, they are recommended to go through a cohort series where we use information like the SBA's information that they've spoken about, FEMA's information. We partner often with the SBA and other government agencies to help them really get that documented plan in place. And then we reassess at the end of that 6 to 8 week cohort. So we often find that many of our businesses may come in at like a 1 or 2, simply because they had not received the information or education. Once they do, they implement this activity, they create that documented plan. As Jason said, they make sure that that is on a digital device so that they can assess that or access that information. And then on the back end of that, once they have actually implemented all those various details, we reassess and their score may have jumped from say a 1 or a 2 to about a 4 or a 5, meaning they are now more resilient because they are prepared. They have a plan of action in place. They have gotten the necessary insurance that maybe they just didn't know about prior to. And then there's often things that are identified in the plan, such as, you know, if it's a restaurant industry, you know, do they have adequate refrigeration? You know, do they have the necessary generators that they might need? And when you're really talking about smaller businesses, when you identify pieces of equipment that they do not have that they need, oftentimes they don't have the capital to support making those purchases. So that's another area where True Fund can support those small businesses, is by offering smaller loans so that they can buy the necessary equipment that they need, such as generators, or again, putting some of the action items that are identified in their resiliency plan in place as it relates to, you know, it's going to cost them additional funds that they just simply do not have. So we can support in that way as well.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Kim. And what we're going to do now is pass over to Anna so she can talk a little bit about the vaccine and the initiatives that the city has. I tell you what, we could talk about this for hours because this is such valuable information. And I wish that we had more participants, but that's okay. We're going to put it on our platforms and they can watch it at another time. But Anna, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Laverne, and thanks for everyone being here, especially to hear all the panelists speak. So my name is Anna. I'm the Community Engagement Coordinator at NOLA Ready, which is the public information branch of NOSAP. And another way that we want to make sure that you all and your businesses are being protected during hurricane season is to get vaccinated. In the case that we have to call for mandatory evacuation, we're still dealing with a pandemic at the moment. And the city of New Orleans has been putting great efforts into doing vaccine outreach throughout different communities, especially the more vulnerable communities throughout the city. And where we can partner up with you all is to assist us in identifying businesses that are able to help host vaccine locations or help us provide incentives. For example, Felipe just last Friday hosted a burrito for a shot event. And with that, they were able to donate a burrito to every person that got vaccinated that day. And we were able to vaccinate about 124 people. And so definitely encouraging, doing the outreach with your staff and asking them if they're vaccinated. Of course, we would encourage you all to provide incentives for your employees rather than making it mandatory just yet, as there's definitely still some hesitancy around getting vaccination. And that's one of the efforts that we're trying to work to overcome is that vaccine hesitancy. And so if you are interested or you know folks who are able to help us in our efforts in New Orleans, I'll go ahead and share my contact information and happy to answer any questions about our vaccine efforts.
Thank you.
So Anna, I have a question. I'm sorry, Mara. So I was on a call today and there is an initiative with Uber and Lyft. Could you talk a little bit about that? Maybe it's something that Mara and I could promote to our small businesses.
Sure. So are you talking about Uber and Lyft providing rides to vaccine sites? Or?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yes. So Uber and Lyft have offered to provide free rides to vaccine sites. Mm-hmm. And so you can call 311 to schedule a ride to a vaccine site. You can find the list of vaccine sites that are hosted by both New Orleans Health Department and NOLA Ready, but also other partner agencies such as 504 HealthNet, Power Coalition, Bring Back Louisiana, several different community organizations that we coordinate with and host these events. And so we essentially have vaccine events every single day. It's now a matter of doing that community outreach to reach the folks who are not so sure or just still holding out to get that vaccine that we're trying to reach. And there's, from our point of view, there's no better way to reach those individuals than working with, the boots on the ground, the small businesses, community organizations, churches that are already in communication and have strong relationships with the community. And so we do have that partnership with Uber and Lyft. We're also, I would say, as it relates to the city assisted evacuation, we're also talking with the rideshare companies about providing free rides to the Smoothie King Center. And that's something that's still being worked out. But, we're definitely keeping in mind all the different ways to encourage residents to get to the Smoothie King Center if they're not able to evacuate the city themselves.
And Laverne, you know, through our national partners, you know, the, in your case, the Black Chamber, in my case, the United States Hispanic Chamber, they, we also have those associations with Uber and Lyft, and they're sending codes and everything, so we can definitely support that. But that, I really would like to ask a question from Anna and Colin regarding COVID vaccines and in the case of an evacuation. What are we going to do? Are we going to encourage people to get vaccinated before, you know, we do an evacuation? What are, so, how are we going to handle COVID with an evacuation?
We're spreading the message far and wide, and we have been for the last several weeks, that the first preparation you should do for hurricane season is to get vaccinated. But what we need to bear in mind is that if we have a category 4 or 5 hurricane bearing down on the city, just like last year when we didn't have a vaccine, it's more dangerous than COVID. And so when you're told to evacuate, you need to evacuate. It's just that getting getting vaccinated is going to be, it's going to make your evacuation a lot safer. And so we're really encouraging that. But either way, when told to leave, you have to leave.
Yeah, and I would just add on that, you know, we're definitely facing, part of the percentage of folks that are unvaccinated we're seeing is that, you know, folks have gotten through a whole year, more than a year now, of a pandemic. Things are starting to open back up again. You know, why should they get vaccinated, right? But, you know, as we're slowly seeing in the news, you know, there are different variants, or as my friends like to call them, scariants, that you really want to avoid, that we can absolutely avoid by getting vaccinated. But, you know, if for some reason you have employees that are still hesitant and, you know, that conversation with them is still not clicking just yet, you know, making sure that masks and hand sanitizer is a part of your hurricane prep for both your go bag and for your, you know, shelter at home, shelter in place bags.
Thank you very much. I know Ms. Joanne had another remark that she wants to make sure that she leaves us with a message. So, Joanne.
Okay, thank you so much, Myra. And we've talked a lot about insurance. And I just wanted to share that if you are successful or have the need to apply for an SBA loan and you get that loan, SBA requires that you maintain insurance on the property. If that property is damaged again and you have allowed that insurance to lapse, then we will not be able to support you. So I know sometimes we get to the point where it's like, what should I pay? Should I pay my insurance or should I pay this? Please keep the insurance up, because it can have dire consequences on you when it comes to trying to get funding from SBA as a result of a disaster. I just wanted to share that. Thank you, Myra.
Thank you very much.
And so, Joanne, thank you. And to all the other panelists, we greatly appreciate the information that you shared with us this evening. It was quite beneficial and very informative. So on behalf of the NRBCC Board of Directors and staff, thank you for joining us tonight. And again, go to our website, www.nrbchamber.org, for further webinars, because we do have quite a bit during the month and they are very informative and would be beneficial to the growth and sustainability of your business. So Myra, thank you. This was great to have us do something together, and I look forward to us doing more things together in the very near future.
Thank you very much, Laverne, and thank you to our amazing panelists. It was wonderful to work together. This, as you can see, we didn't have enough time. We could go on for hours, but this information will be shared. So on behalf of our board and chair, I'd like to thank everyone in attendance and you, Laverne, and the New Orleans Regional Black Chamber for the invitation.
Thank you. That's a good video, Mara. I like that.
Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, Kenneth.